In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman who needed not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Welcome to the Three Angels Herald Prophecy Seminar. We invite you to take your Bible, pen and paper as we study the Word of God. Our speaker for today is Jimmy Kakuri.
And today's prayer thought actually comes from the book Christ Object Lessons. And I'm going to be reading from page 127 through to 128. Christ Object Lessons, page 127 through to 128. Inspiration says, the last paragraph. In every age, there is a new development of truth, a message of God to the people of that generation. The old truths are all essential. New truth is not independent of the old, but an unfolding of it. It is only as the old truths are understood that we can comprehend the new. When Christ desired to open to his disciples the truth of his resurrection, he began at Moses and all the prophets and expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. But, inspiration says, it is the light which shines in the fresh unfolding of truth that glorifies the old. He who rejects or neglects the new does not really possess the old. For him it loses its vital power and becomes but a lifeless form. That's a very, very solemn statement, brethren. Inspiration, first of all, reminds us that in every age there is a new development of truth. And that's something that we need to consider as we go through this Bible study today. We need, brothers and sisters, to understand that if we reject or neglect the new, we do not really possess the old. For us, it loses its vital power and becomes but a lifeless form. So with these words in mind, brothers and sisters, I just want to invite you right now as we petition the throne of grace so that God may lead us and guide us into all truth. Let's pray. Gracious Father in heaven, Lord, nothing we bring, simply to the cross we cling. Speak to us now, give us full understanding of this precious message, and forgive us for every sin. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Now, if you take your Bibles, brethren, and turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 20. And we're going to be reading from verse 1 right through to verse 16. From verse 1 right through to verse 16. In verse 1, the Bible says, for the kingdom of heaven is likened to a man that is an householder, which went out early in the morning to hire laborers into his vineyard. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out the third hour and saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, I will give you. And they went their way. Again he went out the sixth and the ninth and did likewise. And about the 11th hour he went out and found others standing idle, and said to them, why stand ye here all the day idle? They said unto him, because no man has hired us. He saith unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive. So when even was come, the lord of the vineyard saith unto the steward, call the laborers and give them their hire, beginning from the last unto the first. And when they came that were hired about the 11th hour, they received every man a penny. But when the first came, they supposed that they should have received more. And they likewise received every man a penny. And when they had received it, they murmured against the goodman of the house, saying, these last have wrought but 1 hour, and thou hast made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and the heat of the day. But he answered one of them and said, Friend, I do thee no wrong. Didst thou not agree with me for one penny? Take that thine is, and go thy way. I will give unto this last, even as unto thee. Is it not lawful for me to do what I will with mine own? Is thine eye evil because I am good? Verse 16. So the last shall be first, and the first last. For many be called, but few be chosen. Praise the Lord. Now, brothers and sisters, as usual, we have a pictorial representation of this beautiful parable recorded here in Matthew chapter 20. Now, again, we're going to be digging deep into the mind of God's truth today, brothers and sisters. So please, as we tune in to the Holy Spirit, I pray that He may guide us and may enlighten us into all truth. If you take your Bibles, the Bible says, For the kingdom of heaven is likened to a man that is an householder, which went out early in the morning to hire laborers into his vineyard. Now, you will notice as we read these verses in Matthew chapter 20, that the householder went out at five different intervals and called laborers into his vineyard. He went out early in the morning, in the third hour, in the sixth hour, in the ninth hour, and he also went out in the 11th hour. Now you will notice that each of the calls had a 3-hour interval, except the last. The 11th hour call comes within the 3 hours that was allotted to the 9th hour laborers. Did you notice that, brethren? Again, the 11th hour call comes within the 3 hours that was allotted to the 9th hour laborers, just 1 hour before sunset. And really, brethren, this is going to be the focal point of our discussion today. Now, first of all, we need to understand who is the householder in this parable. Now, in the book Christ Object Lessons, in fact, it begins right down the bottom of 396, inspiration says, the householder's dealing with the workers in his vineyard represents God's dealing with the human family. So very clearly we see, brothers and sisters, that the householder is God himself. And we want to say amen to that. But the point is, he goes out early in the morning and hires the first set of laborers. But he then sends them into his vineyard. Now who could the laborers be in verse 1? Whom does God send into his vineyard? Let's go to the book of Luke chapter 10. In the book of Luke chapter 10 and verse 2, the Bible says, Therefore said he unto them, The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. Very clearly we see that the laborers are his disciples, whom he sends into his great harvest field with a message of salvation. And we want to praise God for that, brothers and sisters. Now, notice that the laborers were sent into the vineyard. Now, the vineyard, according to the same book, Christ Object Lessons, page 301, inspiration says, God claims the whole earth as his vineyard. Though now in the hands of the usurper, it belongs to God. Isn't that beautiful? God claims the whole earth as his vineyard. Although it's in the hands of the usurper, it belongs to God. And we want to praise God for that, brethren. So very clearly we've seen so far that the householder symbolizes God. The laborers are his disciples whom he sends into his vineyard. And the vineyard symbolizes the world. God claims the whole earth as his vineyard. Now you will also notice in the parable that there were certain disciples who were standing idle in the marketplace. Now, if the vineyard symbolizes the world, then the marketplace must really symbolize the opposite. In fact, let's go to volume 5 of the testimonies, page 203. Last paragraph, inspiration says, The words of Christ apply to the church. Why stand ye here all the day idle? why are you not at work in some capacity in his vineyard? Again and again he has bidden you, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive. But this gracious call from heaven has been disregarded by the large majority. Isn't that clear, brethren? The words of Christ, why stand ye here all the day idle, applies to the church. And it was in the marketplace where they were standing idle. Therefore, the marketplace in this parable symbolizes the church. And that's why, brethren, we cannot be idle at this time. We have to be aroused and to understand the urgency in which the times in which we are living in. So, brothers and sisters, we've seen that very clearly now, that the household is God, the laborers are the disciples, the vineyard is the world, and the marketplace is the church. Now, again, the householder, who is God, went out early in the morning and hired the first set of laborers. Now, you will notice that the only disciples that Christ made an agreement with were the early morning laborers. Did you notice that, brethren? Look at verse 2. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, he sent them into his vineyard. The only disciples that God made an agreement with were the early morning laborers, the first set of disciples. To the rest, he said, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive. And by the way, all the disciples and all the laborers received every man a penny. Now, we know that an agreement is a contract or a covenant. Amen? Who did God make a contract with and a covenant, symbolized by these early morning laborers? Let's go to the book of Exodus, chapter 19, and verse 5. The Bible says, just as the children of Israel came out of Egypt. Verse 5, the Bible says, now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all the people of the earth, for the earth is mine. Verse 8, and all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord has spoken we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord. So very clearly we see that God said to the people, now if you will obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar people. In other words, brothers and sisters, the covenant that God made was with the children of Israel, just as they came out from the land of Egypt. We can furthermore see this in the book of Haggai, chapter 2. The Bible says in verse 5, according to the word that I covenanted with you when ye came out of Egypt, so my spirit remaineth among you, fear ye not. So very clearly again, we see that the people that God made an agreement with, or a covenant with, were the 12 tribes of Israel. So the early morning laborers, brothers and sisters, were actually the 12 tribes of Israel that God made an agreement with, and he sent them into the vineyard. Now, in the book Christ Object Lessons, page 398, Inspiration says, the Jews had been first called into the Lord's vineyard, and because of this, they were proud and self-righteous. Their long years of service they regarded as entitling them to receive a larger reward than others. So very clearly we see, brothers and sisters, that it was the Jews that were first called into the Lord's vineyard. Now, since that is the case, brothers and sisters, that it was the 12 tribes of Israel that were first called into the Lord's vineyard, we're also going to see now that each of the calls, as the householder went out and called laborers at different intervals of the day, we're going to see, brothers and sisters, that he also gave them a present truth message. That each set of laborers, as God sent them into the vineyard, he also gave them a present truth message. Now again, the Bible says that the early morning laborers, naturally they were called early in the morning. Well, what happens early in the morning? Well, early in the morning we know that the sun rises. Amen? Now what does the sun really symbolize? Now naturally the sun gives light. According to the book of Psalms, chapter 119, verse 105, the psalmist says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Amen. Now, brothers and sisters, being called early in the morning, it shows that during this time, when the children of Israel called, there was a great spiritual awakening. In fact, being called early in the morning, the time when the sun comes up, and the sun being a symbol of the written revelation of God's word, that's exactly what happened when God called the children of Israel. Around this time, Moses began to write the written revelation of God's word. And you can read that in the book Great Controversy, in the preface, page 5. That the significance of the sun coming up early in the morning was that the written revelation of God's word at that time, as God called the 12 tribes of Israel out of Egypt, Moses began to write the first 5 books of the Bible. Which re-emphasizes the fact that these early morning laborers were the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, which special message, brothers and sisters, did God give to the 12 tribes of Israel? Which special message did he give them when he sent them into the vineyard? Now, we know what message he gave them. It was through the sacrificial system. The 12 tribes of Israel were to bring more prominently before the world the uplifted Savior through the sacrificial system. But you may say at this time, but didn't Adam sacrifice? Didn't people prior to the 12 tribes of Israel sacrifice? And the answer to that is yes. But when you understand that the message that God gave to the early morning laborers was the sacrificial system in connection with the sanctuary. Do you remember in the book of Exodus, chapter 25 and verse 8, God said, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. And God's way is through the sanctuary. In other words, God revealed the plan of redemption to his ancient people, the Jews, through the sanctuary services. So the message that God gave to these early morning set of laborers was the sacrificial system in connection with the sanctuary. And we want to say praise God for that. Now, in the book Great Controversy, page 609, on page 609, Inspiration says, different periods in the history of the church have each been marked by the development of some special truth. And we want to keep that in mind, brethren, because we saw through our prayer thought at the beginning of our presentation, in the book Christ Object Lessons, page 127 and 128, where Inspiration says, in every age, there is a new development of truth, a message adaptable to the people at that time, a message of present truth. And the present truth for the early morning laborers was the sacrificial system in connection with the sanctuary. Now let's move on, brethren. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 20, if we go there, in relation to the second set of laborers, in verse 3, the Bible says, and he, the householder, went out about the third hour and saw others standing idle in the marketplace. Now, brethren, there's something that we need to understand as we go through this parable. Anciently, time was regulated by the rising and setting of the sun. Now, here we're dealing with an ancient timepiece. Do you remember in the book of John chapter 11 and verse 9? Jesus said, are there not 12 hours in a day? I must work while it is day, for the night cometh when no man can work. So that's the time in which we're really dealing with here, brothers and sisters. The 12th hour here symbolizes sunrise. The 12th hour on the other side of the clock symbolizes sunset. Now the third hour of the day was 9 o'clock in the morning. Where Christ lived anciently, near the equator, the length of the day and the length of the night were approximately equal. The sun rose approximately around 6 o'clock in the morning. So the first hour after sunrise will be 7 o'clock. The second hour after sunrise will be 8 o'clock. The third hour after sunrise will be 9 o'clock in the morning, and so forth. So the second set of laborers being called at the third hour, that was 9 o'clock in the morning. Now who were these second set of laborers? And what special message did God give the second set of laborers. Now, brothers and sisters, stay with me very closely now, because we saw that the special message that God gave the early morning laborers was the sacrificial system in connection with the sanctuary. Now, we know that those sacrifices of the flock met their fulfillment in Christ, who was crucified on Calvary. In other words, the lamb of the flock just pointed forward. The lamb of the flock pointed forward to the Lamb of God. Since the second set of laborers were called at the third hour, there's something we need to understand there. Turn with me to the book of Mark, chapter 15. In the book of Mark, chapter 15 and verse 25, the Bible says, "And it was the third hour, which was 9 o'clock in the morning, and they crucified him." So Christ was crucified at the third hour, which was 9 o'clock in the morning. In the book of Acts, chapter 2 and verse 15, the Bible says, "After Pentecost, after the Holy Spirit was poured out, and the disciples began to speak in tongues, the people thought that they were drunk." But notice what Peter says in verse 15. Acts chapter 2 and verse 15. "For these are not drunken," Peter says, "as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day." Did you get that? In other words, Christ being crucified at the third hour, and Pentecost around that time also coming at the third hour, gives some form of indication as to the time in which these second set of laborers were actually called. And since the types of the sacrifices met their fulfillment in Christ as he was crucified, because we know when Christ was dying on the cross, as he was about to be crucified, the priest was officiating in the temple. And as he raised his hand to slay the lamb, the knife slips from his hand and the lamb escapes, because type had met antitype on the cross. So that goes to show, brothers and sisters, that the second set of laborers were to be found sometime around the crucifixion. So it shouldn't be too difficult to understand who these second set of laborers really are. That's right, brethren. They symbolize the apostles, the 12 apostles. And the special message that God gave to the 12 apostles, may all the glory be to God, was the death, the life, and the resurrection of his precious son, Jesus Christ. They preached a crucified and risen Savior, that the very person that clothed his divinity and humanity, the Word becoming flesh, was indeed the Son of the living God. And they preached, brethren, that they had a friend now who had ascended up into the heavens and who was now at the right hand of power making intercession for God's people. Oh, brothers and sisters, isn't that beautiful? That was the present truth that the disciples preached. And they were the second set of laborers. Let's go on now, brethren. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 20 and move on to find out now who the sixth and the ninth hour laborers really symbolize. Verse 5 says, "And again he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour and did likewise." Again he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour and did likewise. Did you notice, brethren, that these two next calls are called jointly together? Did you notice that? They are closely related together. God being the householder, he says, he called the early morning laborers, he sent them into his vineyard. And then in next verses, he then calls the third hour laborers. But these next two sets of laborers, the sixth hour laborers and the ninth hour laborers, are very closely related together. Who could they be, brethren? So since we're dealing with present truth, because the early message that God gave to the early set of laborers was a present truth, a message that had not been taught before. The sacrificial system in connection with the sanctuary, for the first time an earthly tabernacle was established on the earth. The second set of laborers preaching that Christ was the Son of God, that was a new message. That he was the Son of God. So which message and which set of laborers are symbolized by the sixth hour laborers? The next present truth message, brothers and sisters, that God gave to the sixth hour laborers was the message foretold in the book of Daniel chapter 8 and verse 14, which says, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Do you know, brethren, that this message was given to the Millerite movement? The sixth hour laborers symbolize the Millerite movement. Now, the Millerite movement was a movement that God raised up in the year 1831 and extended right down to 1844. And that was a very, very precious message. Now, we know, brothers and sisters, through history, that they were to go through a sweet and bitter experience. In fact, they set a time date, and they misunderstood what the cleansing of the sanctuary really symbolized. But nevertheless, the hand of God was in the movement. So, brothers and sisters, the sixth-hour laborers symbolized the Millerite movement, the first-day Adventists. They were not Seventh-day Adventists. For at this time, God's people hadn't kept the Sabbath. But God gave that message to the Millerites. Now, brothers and sisters, maybe at this time you're thinking, well, why couldn't the next movement be the Protestant Reformers? Because didn't Martin Luther bring a message? Wycliffe, Huss, Jerome, and the other great Reformers? The answer to that is yes. But the point is, brothers and sisters, the truth that those Reformers brought was not present truth. For example, Martin Luther preached, the just shall live by faith. When you go back to Holy Scripture, Noah preached faith. In fact, Noah's message is in the book of faith, in Hebrews chapter 11. It's in the chapter of faith. So what the Reformers preached was not present truth as such, but it was truth that really the papacy at that time during the Dark Ages, from the year 538 AD to 1798, the papacy was treading under their feet the truth of God at that time. And God raised up those Reformers to preach and to revive what had formerly been trodden down. So the sixth hour laborers had to be a movement with a message of present truth. Now, brethren, we know that this movement ended in October the 22nd, 1844, after the great disappointment, according to Revelation chapter 10. Thousands upon thousands of the early Adventists abandoned faith. They made shipwreck of faith. But the faithful went back to the Word and saw that the mistake could not have been with God. As we said before, God's hand was upon it. God saw fit to bring His people up to a testing time to prove what was in their hearts. But that movement, the Millerite movement, ended in October the 22nd, 1844. Now remember, going back to Matthew chapter 20, remember we said that these two next movements were co-jointly together. And notice now how beautiful the scriptures entwine together. Where the Millerite movement ended in October the 22nd, 1844, the Seventh-day Adventist movement picked up from. In other words, in that very same year, brethren, 1844, God gave Ellen G. White, who brought the message in relation to the judgment of the dead. God gave Sister White her first vision. She saw the travels of the Advent people. And God raised up the Seventh-day Adventist Church in that very same year, the year 1844. So beautiful as it is, brethren, where the Millerite movement ended, God raised up the Seventh-day Adventist movement in that very same year. Can you see, as Christ spoke this parable, see, Christ, not only being the Son of God, but also being a prophet, as He spoke this parable, His prophetic eye caught the movements that His own hand was to raise up sometime in the future. Where the Millerite movement ended, the Seventh-day Adventist Church was raised up. And that's why God says He went out about the 6th and the 9th, co-jointly together, in that very same year. We want to say praise God to God for that, brethren. That is beautiful. That is marvelous. And as I said before, brothers and sisters, this message of present truth. Flesh and blood has not revealed it. And since we are saved as individuals, it lies down to us to determine whether we're going to march on and keep pace with the truth, or we're going to fall behind and be left without the seal of God. As we go on, brothers and sisters, since these ninth hour laborers were the Seventh Day Adventists that God raised up in that very same year of 1844, which present truth message did God give the Seventh Day Adventist Church? Now we know in 1844, God gave the third angel's message. Now the light that was shed on the third angel's message, because if you read Revelation chapter 14 and verse 9, mention is made of the third angel, that if any man worships the beast or his image, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture. Now light was shed on the third angel, that the mark of the beast was indeed Sunday observance. The third angel's message was the present truth in relation to the judgment of the dead. Because when God raised up the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the ninth hour laborers, in 1844, the judgment began in heaven with the dead. In fact, in the book Great Controversy, page 483, notice what inspiration says here, brethren. As the books of record are opened in the judgment, the lives of all who have believed on Jesus come in review before God. Beginning with those who first lived on the earth, that's the dead, our advocate presents the cases of each successive generation and closes with the living. So when judgment began in heaven, in 1844, when Christ moved from the holy apartment of the heavenly sanctuary into the most holy apartment, judgment began with the dead, with those that first lived on the earth. But inspiration says, it is soon to pass onto the living. So the message that God gave to the Seventh-day Adventist Church was in relation to the judgment of the dead. And I'm going to come back to that. I'm going to come back to that, brethren. The third angel's message in relation to the judgment of the dead. Now, brothers and sisters, stay with me very close now. Because since the ninth hour laborers symbolized the Seventh-day Adventist movement, which God raised up in 1844, what is God really trying to tell us? Because if we go back to Matthew chapter 20, God, the householder, goes out and calls another set of laborers, the 11th hour laborers. Well, if the 9th hour laborers are the Seventh-day Adventists, who can the 11th hour laborers be? And remember, this call is a call within a call, showing that these 11th hour laborers must be Seventh-day Adventists, but they can only be the true and faithful Seventh-day Adventists. In the book Review and Herod, November 19, 1908, inspiration says, it's only those that withstand temptation in the strength of the Mighty One. They're the only ones that will be permitted to proclaim it, the third angel's message, when it swells into a loud cry. So these 11th hour laborers, brothers and sisters, are the faithful Seventh-day Adventists. This 11th hour call comes but 1 hour before sunset, which really tells us that this must be an emergency call, an emergency message. A call for a new set of laborers just 1 hour before sunset indicates that this is an emergency call. Who could these 11th hour laborers really symbolize, brethren? Who could they really symbolize? You see, in volume 3, brothers and sisters, Testaments to the Church, page 266, inspiration has these words to say. She says, the closing work for the church, and we saw that God raised up the Seventh-day Adventist Church, symbolized by the ninth hour laborers. But the closing work for the church is the sealing of the 144,000. This goes to show that the faithful SDAs who are sealed in the church, volume 3266, are the 144,000 guiltless servants of God. And they are the only ones that will be sanctified and sealed and prepared to give the loud cry. Oh, brothers and sisters, if you turn with me to volume 1, Testaments to the Church, page 608. In concluding this narrative, I would say that we are living in a most solemn time. In the last vision given me, and we want to praise God that it was God that gave his messenger this vision. In the last vision given me, I was shown the startling fact that but a small portion of those who now profess the truth will be sanctified by it and be saved. Only a small portion, brethren, will be sanctified by it and be saved. Many will get above the simplicity of the work. They will conform to the world, cherish idols, and become spiritually dead. That is solemn, brethren. No wonder Inspiration says in volume 5, Testaments to the Church, page 217, she says the church had turned back from following Christ her leader and is steadily retreating towards Egypt. Yet she says, only a few are alarmed or astonished at their want of spiritual power. We want to thank God, brethren, that the 144,000 are the ones that recognize their spiritual poverty. They will recognize that they are not rich and increased with goods and in need of nothing, and thus lay hold on everything that God has provided for their salvation. Now turn with me to the book of Revelation, chapter 14. And verse 6, the Bible says, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation. Now the word every means every. Amen? The word every means every. To preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. Now who's going to give this message to every kindred, tongue, people, and nation? Certainly the 11th hour laborers. But brethren, consider this. From verse 1 through to 5, we've just read verse 6. We've just read verse 6 of Revelation 14. But from verse 1 through to 5, mention is made of the 144,000. Did you ever see that? It's going to be the 144,000 first fruits that will have the grand privilege of preaching the loud cry message symbolized by this one symbolical hour from the 11th to the 12th. It's going to be the 144,000 first fruits, sinless, guiltless servants of God, clothed in his righteousness, that will have the privilege of preaching the everlasting gospel to every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. Now, brethren, go back to Revelation chapter 10. When God raised up the Seventh-day Adventist Church in 1844, after the great disappointment, then the angel, look at verse 11, Revelation chapter 10 and verse 11, after the great disappointment of 1844, God raised up the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this was the commission, that's what the Bible says, this was the commission that God gave to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Look at verse 11. And he said unto me, thou must prophesy again before, what's that word there, brethren? Before many peoples, nations, tongues, and kings. Oh, brethren, the word many can never mean all. And the word every can never mean some. Brothers and sisters, let's not be deceived. When God raised up the Seventh-day Adventist movement in 1844, symbolized by the ninth hour laborers, the commission that was given to the Seventh-day Adventist Church was to go to many nations. In other words, the message in relation to the judgment of the dead was to go to many nations. Why? Because God could foresee the great crisis that will happen in the church. The church has turned back from following Christ the leader and is steadily retreating towards Egypt. That's why it made it necessary for God the householder to go out 1 hour before sunset and to call a new set of laborers. The 144,000 guiltless servants of God will be the ones, Revelation 14 and verse 6, that will preach not to many nations, but to every kindred, tongue, people and nation. Oh, brethren, don't miss that point. In other words, the message of the judgment of the living will go to every nation, whereas the message that came in 1844 only went to many. Oh, brothers and sisters, we want to thank God for this revelation. In volume 6, Testaments to the Church, page 406, notice what inspiration says. We are to throw aside our narrow, selfish plans, remembering that we have a work of the largest magnitude and highest importance. In doing this work, we are sounding the first, second, and third angels' messages and are thus being prepared for the coming of that other angel. And are thus being prepared for the coming of that other angel. Another message. From heaven, who is to lighten the earth with his glory. What is this other message, brothers and sisters, that inspiration is here talking about? In doing this work, she says, the gospel work, we are sounding the first, second, and third angels' messages, and we are thus being prepared for the coming of that other angel. Oh, brothers and sisters, the consistency, and we have to be consistent Christians. We have seen consistently that whenever God called a set of laborers, he gave them a special message of present truth. And by the way, brethren, in the book Early Writings, page 63, inspiration says, there are many precious truths in the Bible, but what the flock needs now is present truth. That's right, brethren. As the judgment of the dead began with a message, the third angel's message, so the judgment of the living must begin with a message. Consider that. We are thus being prepared for that other angel who is to come from heaven. Oh, brothers and sisters. You see, in the book Early Writings, page 270, inspiration says, the solemn testimony upon which the destiny of the church hangs has been lightly esteemed, if not entirely disregarded. What is this message, brethren? That will determine our destiny, heaven, but has been lightly esteemed, if not entirely disregarded. Brothers and sisters, it's time to wake up. We need to know what this message is. It means life and death, because the message is the seal of the living God. It's that message that is foretold in volume 6, page 406, that is to come, she says. Oh, brothers and sisters, this message is here. This message, it's here, it's ready, and it's waiting for you to receive it. This message that we are sharing today, brothers and sisters, is the very message that has come. Is the very message that inspiration says is to come. This is the loud cry message of Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1. This is the additional message. In Early Writings, page 277, inspiration says, I saw angels hurrying to and fro in heaven under the chapter of the loud cry, descending to the earth and again ascending to heaven, preparing for the fulfillment of some important event. Then I saw another mighty angel commissioned to descend to the earth to unite his voice with the third angel and give power and force to his message. The work of this angel comes in at the right time to join in the last great work of the third angel message as it swells into a loud cry. And the people of God are thus prepared to stand in the hour of temptation which they are soon to meet. Right down the bottom of 277, inspiration says, this message seemed to be an addition. It's an additional message to the third message, joining it as the midnight cry joined the second angel's message in 1844. Brothers and sisters, this message is an additional message. This message comes in at the right time to prepare the saints for the trying time of temptation, which is just ahead of them. We've seen, brethren, that the 11th hour laborers are the 144,000. And this message comes in at the right time to prepare the saints for the trying time that is ahead of them. Oh, brothers and sisters, it's time to really take God serious. This 11th hour call is an emergency call. It's a call within the corn. It's a call within the 3 hours that was allotted to the ninth hour laborers. And we need to study deeply to know whether this message that has come, we need to know whether we have received it and whether we have made it a part of our everyday lives. Because our very lives, our very salvation depends upon it. Now, brothers and sisters, as we said, it's only going to be the 144,000 from the 11th hour to the 12th that will have the privilege of sharing this message. Now, this call, being a call within a call, also shows a separation. It shows a separation between the 144,000 who shall be sealed and who will give the message in that 1 hour. This also shows again, brothers and sisters, the purification of the church. That God must first purify the church. And the purification of the church is none other than the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. Inspiration says in Manuscript Releases, Volume 1, page 260, study the ninth chapter of Ezekiel. These words will be literally fulfilled. Yet the time is passing and God's people are asleep. God's people are asleep. So the actual call here for the new set of laborers is actually showing a separation also. God will seal the 144,000. Prepare them with this message, the 11th hour message. It is here, brothers and sisters. It is here and waiting. You see, this message of the 11th hour is really in two phases. It's in two phases. It is here. It is waiting for each and every one of us to receive it. Its first phase is under the phase of Revelation chapter 7 and verse 2, which seals the first fruits. That angel ascending from the east seals the 144,000. It's in two phases. This Revelation 18 message must come before the purification. But having come and sealed the 144,000 in the form of Revelation chapter 7 and verse 2, then it prepares the saints to escape the slaughter and then go out filled with the Holy Spirit to proclaim the phase of Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1. Oh, brothers and sisters, we need a deeper consecration. We need a deeper love for the one that was crucified for us. It's no time now to be playing church. The fact that your name is on the church books is not going to give you a ticket to heaven. It's not going to give you a ticket to heaven. We are saved as individuals, and we need to study like we have never studied before. We are living in the great antitypal day of atonement. And fearful things are about to happen. And God is anxious that we may be sealed and sanctified. But brethren, since the sealing is a settling into the truth, then we have to know whether this message has come already. Brothers and sisters, may God bless you. And may God keep you. And as you draw nigh to God, His promise is that He will draw nigh to you. May you be blessed as we go through these series of studies. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Father in heaven, we want to thank you so much, Lord, for this beautiful message that you have given us. Save us, Lord. Save us and keep us. And may we be found worthy, Lord, to be amongst your great people, is my prayer. In Jesus' precious name.
Trust that your hearts have been stirred by the ever-unfolding revelations of God's prophetic word. There are also many more prophecy studies available to you. For further information, please contact us at 1-800-729-7494 or visit us on the World Wide Web at www.3angelsherald.org. Thank you.